Beacon Press Audio presents Narcas, The Secret Rise of Women in Latin America's Cartels by Deborah Bonello. This audiobook is narrated by Mailing Turner, published by Beacon Press Audio, 2019. Author's note. The research for this book was based on a hunch as well as, if I'm honest, a grudge about the way that women are represented in organized crime. Both the hunch and the grudge paid off, and most of my research is based on three main reporting sources: interviews with women and men from the criminal world, as well as experts and law enforcement, court documents outlining cases in the US justice system, and finally, third-party reports and government statistics when I could find them. I can't claim that my methods are terribly scientific compared to those used in academic research, and there was more of an emphasis on qualitative rather than quantitative data. The combination of both types of findings did confirm to me that my hunch, that there are many more women in many more leadership roles in organized crime than most of the existing mainstream literature and coverage would have us believe, was correct. My findings go way beyond the anecdotal. I make no apologies for this. I am a journalist, not a social scientist or statistician. My purpose in writing this book was to create compelling stories and new narratives, as well as share my own stories and experiences in a field where old-school gender tropes still dominate. Due to the nature of the reporting, many of the determining characteristics and names of people I interviewed have been changed or withheld to keep them safe when the book comes out. It's a compromise I'm always willing to make for those willing to share their stories and experiences with me, and I hope that you will trust me enough to relay their stories fairly and accurately without always shining a light on who they are. Introduction. Standing alone at the front of a Chicago courtroom, Guadalupe Fernandez Valencia wore orange prison coveralls. Her long, light brown hair, streaked with grey, was pulled back into a tight ponytail at the nape of her neck. She wore no makeup. She was 60 years old. I want to take advantage of this opportunity to ask forgiveness from my children and from my family, said Guadalupe. It was August 2021, and she was about to be sentenced for a sobering litany of drug trafficking charges, including conspiracy to transport and distribute and money laundering. Guadalupe spent more than three decades in the drug business, working for Joaquin El Chapo Guzman, the world's most famous drug lord, and his Sinaloa cartel. She is, to date, the highest-ranking female Sinaloa cartel operative to emerge into the public eye. When El Chapo was convicted by a court in New York in February 2019, it was the climax of the highest-profile organized crime case of my generation. During his trial, news reporters had to arrive at 3 or 4 in the morning to get a seat for the day. El Chapo's adventures and those of other male traffickers have inspired Hollywood movies, Netflix series, and countless books and novels. Few women have. So when I looked at the indictment that sent El Chapo down, an indictment on which Guadalupe was the only woman, I was struck by how unknown her story is to the world. Some superficial Googling revealed coverage of the guilty plea she made and not much else. In the history of the drug trade, public focus is nearly always on the male protagonists. Yet Guadalupe, known as La Patrona, a Spanish term for a female boss, had a criminal career that ran parallel to that of El Chapo. She was arrested in Mexico just a month after his final capture. I wondered, as she awaited her sentence in the dock, if she had calmed herself by picturing the green mountains and remembering the soft air of home, the smell of wood smoke in the mornings. Did the memories of Michoacán, the humid southern Mexican state where she was born, soothe her in that difficult moment? Any happy childhood memories had no doubt been sullied when the crime lords moved into her home state when she was a teenager. They plundered the heroin, poppy, and marijuana plantations in the picturesque mountains, holding humble farmers to ransom by controlling the price for poppy paste that the farmers had no choice but to accept. Those who spoke up in self-defense were either silenced or co-opted. Eventually, the drug gangs took over entire villages like hers, often abusing the community's younger women. They would grow to dominate not just the lucrative production of heroin and crystal meth, but the mineral and gold mines dotted around the state, as well as the avocado and lime industries. Guadalupe escaped them for a time by coming to the United States like millions of her countrymen and women before her. But now, here she was, one of them. The bosses she had worked for fronted a billion-dollar multinational operation that had tentacles reaching around the globe. They didn't just dominate a single Mexican state. They were the biggest criminal organization in the world. "I wish I could find the words to convince you of how sorry I am," Guadalupe told Judge Sharon Johnson Coleman in court in Chicago. She was handed down a 10-year sentence, 7 years of which she had already served. But El Chapo got life. Some of the substantial evidence, according to U.S. prosecutors, that eventually put him behind bars after a criminal career spanning more than four decades, came from Guadalupe. During her time working with the Sinaloa cartel, Guadalupe worked closely with Jesus Alfredo Guzman Salazar, known as Alfredillo, one of El Chapo's sons. His name is on the same charge sheet as both Guadalupe's and his father's, but he remains at large in Mexico. Court documents describe Guadalupe as Jesus's lieutenant. They worked together on the entire drug distribution process, from start to finish, and she was a fundamental part of the organization, prosecutors say. Her crucial role in the cartel makes it even more interesting that she is so unknown. When I, a dedicated narco nerd, first learned about her, my curiosity was piqued. By then, I had been reporting from Latin America for more than a decade, with my main focus on organized crime. I had become part of a growing group of women who were documenting the drug trade, its dynamics, and its protagonists. A lot of the coverage of narco issues in general has been dominated by male writers and macho narratives. The way these stories have been told, men as victimizers and women as victims, feels excessively based on gender tropes. When Guadalupe Fernandez Valencia's story inspired the idea for this book, I had a hunch that this way of viewing the trade was so one-dimensional that it was untrue, but I knew that I had to dig deeper to prove it. I wasn't interested in finding female versions of the male cabrones, hard macho bastards, that we constantly see in media representations of the cartels. Rather, I wanted to understand how women's power manifests in this context, beyond its juxtaposition with men's. On a visit to the Mob Museum in Las Vegas to give a talk on the investigative work for this book in June 2022, I stood in front of a wall adorned with the faces of the 100 years of made men and their associates. There must have been 100 men and just four women hanging on that wall. It was a stunning reminder of how broadly invisible female faces have been in organized crime over the years. Friends of mine who have written books about the drug trade have told me unabashedly that there are barely any women in their work, admitting that they might have missed something there. I remember being told on numerous occasions in the field, while covering some of the violence waged on communities by drug cartels, a few of them while I was quite pregnant, that I should probably be at home. Now seems the right time to talk about the real, gritty, unexpected part women play in organized crime. Characters such as Wendy Bird, Ruth Langmore, and Darlene Snell in the Netflix series Ozark, and Polly Gray in Peaky Blinders, are changing the narratives about women working in criminal businesses, adding nuance and color that contradict cliches. Women such as Megan Rapinoe have emerged in traditionally male sports as icons and advocates. All of these dynamics feel connected to what I've discovered about women in the ranks of organized crime. Most of the women who have been visible in the drug trade are highly sexualized narco wives or girlfriends. The little coverage they have received tends to focus on their sexual attractiveness and attachments to the male narcos, rather than their business power, the message being that if they're not attractive, they don't warrant investigation or attention. Emma Coronel, Guzman's much younger, infinitely more glamorous wife, epitomizes this dynamic. She was a constant presence at her husband's trial and also appeared on VH1's Cartel Crew, where she chatted with the family members of other drug traffickers over glasses of champagne about how to create a brand from her husband's criminal legacy. She was eventually taken into custody on a visit to Washington, D.C. in early 2021. Prosecutors alleged that she was part of a plan to break her husband out of prison for a third time before he was extradited to the United States to face trial. They also claimed that she knew about his drug trafficking activities and the origin of the proceeds. She was an enabler, the classic gangster's moll. Emma eventually turned herself in and was given a relatively light sentence despite her alleged offences. The romantic or family attachments of women in the drug trade are often used to minimise or marginalise them as protagonists. Emma's role as El Chapo's wife is a great example. The logic seems to be that women are there because they're someone's wife or lover or sister or daughter. But men also enter the trade by virtue of their family connections. Most organised crime business is also family business. And yet their influence is assumed to be larger or more important, a virtue of their maleness rather than their familial connections. Those blood or love ties are never used to explain and minimise their presence in the way they are for women. Then there are the other women most visible in organised crime, the victims. Impoverished single mothers obliged to sell or smuggle drugs to support their families, or women coerced to entrap and kill, women trafficked into undesirable trades. Prisons across the region are home to thousands of women like this, who are serving long sentences for relatively small crimes. But within the binary of characterising narco women as either wives or victims, I started to see so much more. I saw women as protagonists and decision makers in the criminal underworld and the drug trade. I saw them in roles in which their romantic or family connections were a sidebar. Women like Guadalupe and the other protagonists in this book, women in gangs in Central America, women operating extortion rackets, women involved in narcomenudeo, street-level drug crime.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.